Hello there. Hope you're all doing well. I'd like to welcome you to this IELTS General Reading Preparation video. Today, we are going to learn all about the multiple choice question type. Now, you might already be familiar with this because this question type is actually quite common in the university setting or in schools, and it's the one IELTS question type that you're likely to see outside of IELTS on different exams and school, like I said. And so we're going to really talk about the strategy that you should use for multiple choice when it comes to the IELTS general reading section. So we'll give you some features, some strategies, and then we're going to get right into our step-by-step example. We've got a good one for you today, so I hope you're ready. Let's get started. All right, so this question type, basically, as you probably know, is going to ask you to choose the correct answer from a list of options. And most often, you're going to have 3 to 4 possible options. 4 is the common number, the most common that you'll see on the IELTS exam. But sometimes you might be asked to pick 2 out of 5 options and 3 out of 6. These are a little bit rare, but they do happen. And in this case, you just have to follow the strategy, but pick more than one option. Our example today is looking at 4 possible options. And so we're going to use the scanning and understanding. So basically, scanning and skim reading, because you need to find keywords in order to understand where the information is located in the passage, and then understand what is written about that keyword and information. And also the format here, you're either going to complete a sentence, which is your question, or you're going to answer a question. In our example today, we are going to complete a sentence. Okay, so we have a guide for you today, and it's about 3 steps. First, we're going to read the questions and underline the keywords in the questions. Now, you might be thinking, that sounds time-consuming. And there is a lot to do in this step, but I'm going to show you how to practice this strategy so that you can get really good at it and then maximize your time and do it quickly. So today, I will be explaining this for you, but with more practice, you'll be able to do this on your own and underline and understand quite quickly. As we do that, I want you to pay attention to absolute words. These are really tricky, and they show up pretty often in the multiple choice question type. So these are basically adverbs of frequency, plus some other words like mainly, or only, or things like no, and these can drastically change the meaning of a statement. So pay attention to that, because it might be different in the passage. So once we've done that, we've understood our words, we know the general idea of our question set, then we're going to go to the passage and scan for the information from step 1. And once we scan for the information, we should be in a promising area to skim read as necessary. So note that we're not going to be reading from the very beginning. We're not going to read the entire passage word for word and looking to understand the whole passage. We just need to pick the parts that are beneficial to us and that will answer these questions. Also, it is important to note that the multiple choice question type usually comes in order, not always, anything can happen, but for the most part, any multiple choice question type should be in order more or less. So in that case, it's really helpful if you make marks in your passage, because if you have a difficult question, we can skip it and come back to it. And if you make marks in your passage, you'll know which area offered up answers and which area didn't. So this will be helpful as well. Today we'll be in section 3. So section 3 is the last section out of all 3 in the general reading test, and it's considered to be of a general interest topic. But I want you to keep in mind that the topic can be anything, but it's generally considered to be more complex than sections 1 and 2. So examples include perhaps the history of something, or a breakdown of a new discovery, some sort of scientific research. It's going to be a bit abstract, and you might find this to be the hardest of the 3 sections. But don't worry, we are going to tackle it together. So let's get started on our step-by-step guide. Okay, so on the left-hand side, you will see our steps. We're starting with step one. And on the right-hand side, we have our set of questions. Now, we have a lot for you today, and I really like this example because it's difficult. You have a lot of questions. We have questions 28 to 36. So let's get started. Like I said, we're going to have the most common example today. So choosing the correct letter, A, B, C, or D, and we have to finish the sentence. Okay, so we don't have questions, we have statements that we will have to finish. All right, so let's get started with our step one, reading the questions and underlining key words. So the first thing you should do is prepare yourself to look over each question, each option, and underlining your keywords. So I know you're probably thinking, that's a lot of work. Believe me, with practice, it really pays off. Today, I'm going to take it a bit slower with you because I'd like to show you why certain words were selected, because you need to know which keywords to select. Stick with me today, and then when you practice, really try to speed up your steps. So I'm going to show you the keywords that we chose, okay? And remember, these keywords make the sentence, make the piece of information unique. So we'll go through them together quickly, and then we will go on to our next step. So if we look at number 28, we have psychologists and PhD. So already we know we're talking about psychology, psychologists, and we're looking at those who have a PhD. And we have four options. Here we have must. This is a very important modal verb. It's an important word in this case because it's very strong. Must work, 4-year higher education. So notice how I haven't looked at institution because that is understood. Okay, I know that 4-year institution is some sort of academic setting. So I have must work, 4-year higher education. Here we have most likely studied specific psychology. So we're looking at a specific area. C, automatically qualified, 4-year institution. And in this case, I know that they are qualified to work or teach in this institution. And then usually not careers in academia. So we have not here, like I said, very important word. So see quickly, even though we're just looking at the keywords, you should have an idea, an understanding of what we are talking about. Now we're looking at a specific term in number 29. We see it's maybe a set of principles, studies to candidates. So it could be something taught to candidates, something that candidates learn. B, differentiates level PhD. So again, you can see the PhD refers to psychology candidates, but in the text, you should be looking for a level or a PhD. C, only, we have our absolute word here, that's very important, only candidates liberal arts. So we know that it's talking about candidates in a liberal arts college or institution. And D, specific doctor of philosophy. And this is a nice synonym for something like this in number 28, PhD. All right, so along with PhD, this is a great keyword because we see it pretty often here. We see earning PhD, dissertation, we have A, optional, B, always, another absolute word here, always defended, expert's field, C, complete description, experiments, training, candidate completed. Okay, and if you have to read more about this when you are selecting your answer, you can see the other words that help you really make sense of what is here. D, required job interviews, 4-year institutions. So again, we have institutions of 4 years. And there you go. I'll scroll down a bit just so we can see the rest of our options. Okay, 31, requirements, PhD. So we're looking at requirements. Again, we have some absolute words. A, usually depend, country, degree attained. So we're looking at a place here. B, different institution. So they're different in each institution. C, mostly oral, project-based, that's very clear. D, do not overlap, doctoral and candidate. All right, let's scroll down some more for number 32. Candidates apply full-time faculty, university, so we're looking at a different level here. And this is lovely because A, B, C, D all start with can expect to. So we can ignore that for now, and we can see A, hired while obtaining PhD, so at the same time. B, we have all, another good absolute word, all time, task, teaching, and researching, or teaching or researching. So see here, we have an option between teaching or researching. That's good to keep in mind. C, involved responsibilities and activities. And D, other careers outside education. So these are all very different. And it's important to note that while they are very different, can expect to is located in each one. So the passage should have a very clear answer for number 32. Number 33, PhD, teach in higher education. So we're looking at specific people here. A, pursuing degrees, more likely career outside of education, so they're more likely to have another career. Train adjunct professors, spare time, very specific here. And D, move to different institutions, that's also pretty specific. 34, we're looking at a specific type of faculty, so I've underlined adjunct faculty. And here we have usually, so this is another adverb of frequency, this is good to know. A, mentors graduate, so mentors to graduate students. B, offset burden, extra courses. C, bridge gap. And we see here the gap would be between research and full-time teaching. D, complete training, accreditation, PhD. And now we're looking at two-year colleges, so this is quite different than the four-year institutions we read about earlier. Increase two-year colleges, career opportunities, potential faculty. B and C is quite interesting because we have these absolute terms again. B and C are very similar, so this is something to watch out for. Only increases opportunities, and then we have two options. B would have PhDs, C would have master degrees. So these are different here, very specific, we have to watch out for that. And D, competition, enrollment, again, we have four-year institutions. And the last one, we have 36, and this is about a self-governing career path. Very interesting. A, usually again, adverb of frequency, PhD, years, for a few years. B, likely not accepted, and then higher education, very specific. C, most likely, again, it's an absolute term, on-the-job training, professional. And D, usually not, prepared, challenge. So we have our negative absolute term here. So we have just scanned everything. Again, like I said, I took longer with you because I was explaining and reading out. This should definitely not take you that long, and with more practice, you'll be able to minimize the time. But I would just want to point out that doing this has basically outlined the passage, what we're about to read. And this is great because, like I said, section 3 is the most complex, so it never hurts you to take some time, outline the passage for yourself, and already be aware of what you have to answer. So in the back of my mind, I know that I'm going to read about four-year institutions, I'm going to read about philosophy, PhDs, masters, two-year institutions, career paths, adjunct faculty. I already know this. And so when I go to step 2, like we just see here, and when I go to the actual passage, I already know what we're going to read about, so I'm feeling more confident, I'm feeling ready, and I'm not nervous that I'm going to come into contact with something that I'm not prepared for. So this step 1 really has 2 great strengths and 2 great advantages for you, knowing the information and also preparing you psychologically for feeling confident and really understanding what you are about to get into, especially in section 3. Okay, so let's continue on. We have our step 2. Like I said, we're now going to scan for information in the passage. Okay, so we're going to start scanning, and we should be remembering to use process of elimination. We will do that together. So when we know that an answer definitely isn't correct, we can eliminate it with a mark, and that will really help us. And then I'll just introduce you to this step now so we can do it all together. We're going to skim read in the passage where we think we have found a good area. So scanning is important, but in order to actually answer these questions correctly, we need to understand the information. So we're going to check on the answer options, skim, eliminate. It's kind of like multitasking with the multiple choice. It's a good way to remember it. So I'll do that together with you and you will see how I approach it. Now I'm going to just scroll down here. Remember, our options are A, B, C, or D. And we're going to write our answer right here. And I'll have two questions on the screen at a time, just so that everything is clear and neat. Since we have a lot of questions, and this is a passage of about, you know, normal length, I would actually start scanning at the very beginning, because answers are most likely going to come in order. So I want to start in the beginning just because it makes the most sense. If you have two multiple choice questions, for example, you might not have the answers in the beginning. I will say that they're probably going to be confined to a general area, but if we only had two questions in this case, it could very well be at the end. So it could be for these last two paragraphs. Okay, but since we have a lot of questions, more than likely we're going to have to scan most of the text. Okay, are you ready? Let's get started. Again, here we're looking for psychologists and PhD. So of course, we have the first word is psychologists, but just from scanning and looking at things, I see already four-year institution and I see PhD. So I'm just going to sort of take a chance here. I see PhD. I know how the strategy works. I'm going to start reading here. And it says, in most areas, this translates into earning a PhD in a relevant area of psychology, such as family counseling or trauma. Okay, so already here, if I scan, I see PhD again, but here I see philosophy in quotations. So I know just from my previous step that philosophy in quotations is in number 29. So this is most likely going to be number 29, meaning if I'm following everything correctly, I'm just going to delve into this a bit more so that I can answer number 28. So I see again, PhD, relevant area of psychology, such as family counseling or trauma. Now, family counseling and trauma were not in my options, but these are specific areas of psychology. We also see area here, relevant area. And this leads me to B, because B says they have most likely studied a specific area of psychology. And again, the beginning of the sentence says in most areas. So this is most likely, very similar here. And if I read on, it, you know, gives more examples like biological psychologist or clinical psychologist. These are all specific. So I'm thinking it's B. I do see four-year institution. So let's talk about that. It says psychologists must work in a four-year institution of higher education. So psychologists who hold a PhD must work in four-year institutions. Let's see if this follows along with that. This says, in general, anyone wishing to continue a career in psychology at a four-year institution must earn a doctoral degree. Now, this is not saying the same thing, but it's a very common trick for the IELTS exam, because you see the word must, you see four-year institution, and if you just scan without skimming and truly understanding what you're reading, most people would put A, even though it's not saying the same thing. This is saying that if you want to have a career in psychology at a four-year institution, then you must have a doctoral degree. This is saying if you have a doctoral degree, you must work in a four-year institution, and that is not what is in the text. So I would immediately eliminate A. That's a tricky one here. The other option that says four-year institution also doesn't have anything to do with this passage, because it doesn't talk really about automatic qualification. I would eliminate C. Usually do not pursue careers in academia. That is not here, so I will eliminate that. I am really confident that B is the correct answer, so I'm going to go ahead and put B. Okay. Now, like I said, 29 is most likely going to be here because we see the term philosophy. So it's a broad term. And we see here, this is perfect, refers diverse disciplinary perspectives grouped together, traditional college of liberal arts and sciences. All right. So I see liberal arts. And I remember liberal arts was a keyword in C, but I have this absolute term. So it's only used for candidates studying in liberal arts colleges. No, it doesn't say only in this paragraph. It doesn't really differentiate that. So I'm going to eliminate C. Refers to specific details, Specific details, not really. It just says diverse disciplinary perspectives. I would not say it's D. If we look at B, differentiates the level of PhDs, we don't see anything about different levels, so I would go ahead and eliminate that as well. A, refers to a set of principles and studies taught to candidates. And we have refers, just like we have refers in D. Refers is in here. Diverse disciplinary perspectives. So this is a nice synonym for something vague like principles that could work and studies taught to candidates. So in this case, the fact that grouped together, we have set of principles and studies. These principles and studies could be grouped together. Taught to candidates would also make sense because we see traditional college of liberal arts. So that's the way it is taught. I would go ahead and put A, even though this is quite a tricky example. D is not looking like the best option because nothing here talks about the specific details. This is pretty vague. It looks like a set of principles. So I'm going to go ahead and put A. If for some reason you just weren't able to get that answer on your own and you were in between A and D, notice how process of elimination would still give you a 50% chance of getting the correct answer. So if anything, just try to make your best educated guess. All right, so we already have two answers done. I'm going to clear our screen to make sure that everything is nice and clean, and we'll go on to the next two. And I'm pretty confident that we're going to be somewhere here, so I've scrolled down as well. Okay, so we're looking at dissertation, okay? That is the main keyword here. And of course, we see dissertation right here, so we're moving right along. So what is a dissertation? We see it's a thorough research paper describing experiments or studies done as part of the doctoral training of a candidate. Okay, let's stop there. Let's think about our keywords. Is it optional? Doesn't say it's optional because it says here they can expect to complete one, so definitely not optional. We can eliminate that. Always defended before a committee of experts. Let's go to C, a complete description of various experiments relating to the training a candidate has completed. That sounds very, very similar to what we have here, but let's just check with D. Required during job interviews in four-year institutions. Nothing here is talking about job interviews, so I'm going to eliminate that. I just want to read again because we were looking at B, always defended before a committee. So I do see something about defense, so let's read here. In order for the degree to be conferred, a dissertation usually must be defended before a committee. However, this requirement varies depending on the country. See how these absolute words and these modal verbs like must can really trick you. That means B is definitely not the answer because it is not always defended. And so, even if we didn't understand it, C is the answer, okay? But in this case, we were quite lucky because it was quite clear. It is a complete description of the experiments, okay? Because thorough is a nice synonym for complete. Okay, good job. Now we're looking at number 31, the requirements for completing PhD. So we're looking for requirements. Now, even though I see PhD here as a keyword, this is when someone earns a PhD. And I have requirement up here like I saw before. So I'm actually going to stick in this paragraph. I'm going to stay here and see if I can find the answer. So we're looking at the requirements. Remember, the keywords were usually, depending on the country, different in each institution. We have oral project-based learning and do not overlap with doctoral training. So right away, I don't see anything about oral project-based. I'm going to eliminate that. Although you could say the fact that something is defended is oral, but that's not very clear. So I'm going to eliminate C. And I remember thinking about the country because for number 30, we were looking at the country and it says this requirement varies depending on the country. So it would be true that the requirements depend on the country. So I'm thinking it would be A, but let's just make sure. Are different in each institution. Doesn't really talk about the differences between institution. It just talks about country. So I'm going to eliminate B. D, do not overlap with doctoral training. And I remember talking about doctoral training before. It says the thorough research paper describing experiments or studies done as part of the doctoral training. So this means that it actually does overlap. They're done at the same time, so this would be false. And there we have it. We have used process of elimination again, even though we were quite confident that A was correct. Excellent. So we found two answers in this paragraph here. I will clear our screen and just move down again. We are going through these and explaining at the same time, so I hope you're still sticking with me and doing this on your own. I'm going to scroll down at this point because I remember that our keyword here was working full-time faculty university level, and already I see our PhD and university, so I'm going to go here. Now I see something about multitasking, splitting time between teaching, research, service to the institution. So let's see. This was our tricky one where we had can expect. So we have all of these. Now let's look at some expectations and what is expected of professors. And it says, can expect to be hired while obtaining a PhD. Nope, the first sentence really just shows that that is not correct because it says once someone earns a PhD, so after. So we can eliminate A. Can expect to devote all of their time, so that's all of their time on a given task. And this is the complete opposite of that because it says this involves multitasking. So we can eliminate B. C, can expect to be involved in various responsibilities and activities. That looks about right, but let's just make sure. D, can expect to have other careers outside of education. Nothing about careers outside of education comes up. It does talk about professors relocating, but nothing about having another career. So I'm going to eliminate that and write C because that looks like the most promising option and it makes sense. Okay, moving on to number 33. We are still talking about those who have a PhD and teach in higher education. So it might be in this paragraph as well. Let's explore here. Let's just read here. It says, professors relocate, okay. And I do remember that in our keyword, we talked about moving to different institutions and opportunities. So that rings a bell, but it says they have to find the best personal fit among various academic environments. Okay, now I'm thinking it could be D, but let's just show you the other options. C, it says train adjunct professors, and we still don't see anything about adjunct professors. We do see something down here. We haven't read this, but I don't see anything that talks about training these faculty, so I'm going to eliminate that. B, they're more likely to obtain a career outside of education. This is very similar to what we saw in number 32. And so I'm going to eliminate that because it doesn't really fit here and end up pursuing other degrees as their careers progress. We don't see that as well. So I'm going to eliminate A and I'm going to put D. Now, of course, if you have a tricky passage and one of these answers ends up coming lower in the passage, you can also skim read to make sure that these are not included in the passage. But I'm thinking about time, I'm thinking about strategy, and with this question type, I'm confident that they're very likely to come in order, and if need be, I can always check my answers later on. Also, I just want to point out something here that's pretty interesting. If you see that B, you see are more likely to obtain a career, is very similar to D, can expect to have other careers, and this is done on purpose. Because there are some cases where, unfortunately, students just don't have the best strategy and they can't finish on time. So like I said, you don't want to leave anything blank. A question type that contains two similar answers gives the impression that it's the correct answer because it's two similar ideas. And if you were just reading this quickly and choosing what you think to be the best answer without reading the passage, you are more likely to pick something that looks similar. And note how they are both incorrect for both questions. So just keep that in mind. Okay, let's clear our screen and move down again. We've got three left. So, okay, we're almost there. And it says here, adjunct faculty members. Finally, we're going to talk about these adjunct faculty members. And I'm just going to scroll down a bit because, oh, we're finished with our passage. So I'm going to scroll down here so you can see adjunct faculty members. Now we're looking at how they are usually hired And it says, in these cases, it is not uncommon to find these members. Let's look at this sentence then to understand the case. And it says, oftentimes schools offer more courses in psychology than their full-time faculty can handle. Okay, let's just see what our options are again and our keywords. Serve as mentors. That doesn't look like it's going to be an option here. To offset the burden of extra courses on full-time faculty. That is pretty much what is written here. And we see our keyword, full-time faculty. But let's just check the other options. Bridge the gap between doctoral research and full-time teaching. Let's skip that for now. And D, to complete the necessary training and accreditation for PhD. Now, nothing here later in the paragraph says anything about accreditation or PhD. So I'm confident that we can skip that. But I just want to look at C, to bridge the gap between doctoral research and full-time teaching. Let's say you don't know what adjunct faculty is. If you read here, you can see, although adjunct faculty members have the necessary training to teach, they often hold primary careers outside of the academic setting. So in this case, they are qualified. There isn't a gap between research and teaching. So I would definitely eliminate that and write B, as that seems to be the correct answer. Okay, 35, we have an increase of two-year colleges. And if I scroll down here, I already see two-year colleges. So I see that keyword, great scanning. And we want to see what this increase is all about. So we see it's coming into fruition. Many of them are in need of faculty to teach their psychology courses. So they're increasing, coming into fruition. They need faculty. And so the increase I see here provides more career opportunities for potential faculty. Yeah, that does seem like that is exactly what is happening, because we see here that faculty members who don't have a doctoral degree use these opportunities to gain experience in teaching. And so many of the faculty are teaching psychology courses. So this makes a lot of sense. I would say it's A already, but I'm just going to eliminate this for you as well. B, only increases opportunities for candidates who hold PhDs. And we've just read that faculty members may not hold doctoral degrees. And so if we read here, it says many of the people who pursue careers at these institutions, so the institutions are referring to two-year colleges, hold at least one master degree in psychology. Okay, so no, it does not only increase opportunities for PhDs, because master degree candidates can also apply. So this is definitely incorrect. Note how this absolute term really changed this option. C, only increases opportunities for candidates who have master degrees. That is definitely not correct, because we see here, although some PhDs choose to develop careers, so that is not correct, provides competition in terms of enrollment and four-year institutions. Four-year institutions are here, but there isn't anything about enrollment. That is not even the topic of this passage, so I would definitely eliminate D. And like we said earlier, A looks like the best option. I also want to call your attention to the fact that B and C were very similar. A and D were different. And a lot of multiple choice question types will have two very similar options. This is also to confuse you. All right, our last question. Let's just make sure we can see it. This is our last question, number 36. And we have individuals who choose to follow self-governing career path. Okay, so self-governing career path. Let's look for something similar here. I see right away, independent career and individuals, we could say PhD graduates, that fits. So let's look here. Independent career, they establish an office and we could say therapy sessions, okay? Usually, and this is interesting because usually was also a key word here, these individuals completed job shadowing or internships with experienced psychologists during academic career, preparing them for best practices. Okay, so we know that we're in the right area because independent career is a synonym for self-governing career path. So we see, have usually had a PhD for a few years. Nothing here talks about that. I'm going to skip that for now. We're likely not accepted to work in higher education. No, that is definitely not an option. I would also eliminate A because upon further reading, you see here that it says recent PhD graduates. So had PhD for a few years, does not fit with that. C, most likely completed on-the-job training with professional. And we see here, usually, all right, so that's a nice similar way to say most likely. They completed job shadowing with an experienced psychologist, so that is a professional. I would say it's definitely C, but let's just look at D. Are usually not fully prepared for the challenge. This is completely out of the picture. It's not anything like what we read here, so that is definitely one to eliminate. And it is true that they most likely completed training with a professional. So I'm going to put C. Wow, so I'm going to clear our screen. That was a whirlwind. Again, I took a little bit longer with you today, a lot longer, just to explain everything and eliminate as necessary. We started from the beginning, we ended here. It looked like the answers came in order. But notice how we didn't read word for word every single word or every single paragraph. That is not necessary, and that will actually decrease the time you have for everything else. So definitely do not do that. We didn't even have to read this last paragraph because it doesn't look like it would be useful for us. So let's just make sure we have all of our answers written in, and we do. It's the moment of truth. Let's check our answers. And it looks like they are all correct. If you look here on the right-hand side, this is everything that we discussed. This has our answers, which came in order, and the reasoning behind them. All right, great job. Let's go over the main points and finish up. Okay, we are finished for today. I just want to leave you with some helpful wrap-up tips. Let's go over some do's, so things you should be doing. Of course, you want to read the questions first and underline your key words. This is really the base of a successful strategy. So when you do that, I want you to pay attention to your absolute terms because this has the power to change the meaning of what you are reading. And then as you are scanning and skimming for answers, use process of elimination. This will really help you for difficult questions. If you are in between two options, process of elimination will help you make your best guess if you really just don't know. So it will minimize your chances of getting something incorrect. And if you have something very difficult, make marks in your passage as the answers usually come in order like we saw today. So if you have an answer for number 9, you can make a mark like a little star, and perhaps you have the answer for number 12 down here. You've already increased your chances of finding number 10 and 11 in the middle. So definitely make marks and use that to your advantage. Things that you should be avoiding: do not read the entire passage first. We've already talked about this, but it will not do you any favors because you will be reading blindly and then you'll be stuck with a lot of questions to answer, and that just isn't the way to go about this. Connected to the process of elimination, do not leave any answers blank, especially for the multiple choice question type, because if you're using process of elimination effectively, you should have fewer options to choose from. So really, if you just do not know and you don't want to waste any more time on it, make your best educated guess based on process of elimination. And of course, don't forget to pay attention to wording and answer options. In addition to the absolute terms, things can just be a little tricky here as the exam is trying to confuse you. So just make sure you know exactly what you are reading in your questions. All right, great job today. Thanks for sticking along and working with me. I hope that you will visit us at www.bestmytest.com/IELTS. Here we have a lot of great strategies and tips and additional practice for you. So go on over there and continue on your IELTS journey. Thanks again. Have a great day, and I'll see you for the next lesson.